Okay, hi everyone. Today I'm gonna talk about our recent work, doing logic proof with sublinear amortized cost. It is co-worked by me and Mike Loslack from Oregon State University and Payman from Yahoo Labs. So what is doing logic proof? Informally, a doing logic proof is a proof system that for one party says a prover that can convince another party says verifier that given statement is true, and besides that, the verifier should learn nothing from the proof. Okay, so for example, the prover can convince the verifier that there exists a Hamiltonian path in a large graph, but without showing this path to the verifier or leaking any other useful information. So we noticed that there already exist some efficient solutions for some special case of genealogical proof. But in our work, we focus on the general purpose genealogical proof. Okay. So in the first part, I'll show some possible solutions. The first one is by using the circuit. So since the general purpose genealogical proof is just a special case of malicious 2PC. So we can just interpret the proof statement as a Boolean circuit and then use the garbled circuit to implement the genealogical proof and use the cut and choose technique to achieve malicious security. But it has some limitations. First, the conversion to a circuit may lead to a huge blow up both in the circuit size and the running time. And second, it is inefficient in some cases. For example, the binary search or the membership statement proofs. Okay. So in membership statement proofs, we want to show that a variable X, if a variable X is a member of the larger data set S. Okay. Another possible solution is to use a random access machine. In a standard run program, there is a CPU with some small internal states, and also there is a memory which has a large size of data. And the CPU can execute some instructions like to read the data from the address one. We call this instructions as access pattern. Then the CPU will go to the next internal state and ready for executing the next instruction. Okay. There are two other possible instructions. First one is to write the data into the memory, and another one is to halt, which indicates that the run program will be terminated. So as you can see that in the standard run program, we only need to touch the data that will be used in access pattern. So in this example, we can see that we only need to touch the data in address 1, 2, and 3. There is a variant of the standard run program, which is oblivious run. It was first introduced by Goldrich and Ostrovsky in 1996. As you can see that in the standard run program, if we encrypt the data, the access pattern can still leak important information. So for example, if the CPU trying to access the same memory over and over again, and then the adversary will notice that, and this will leak important information to the adversary. But in the oblivious RAM, this memory access pattern looks random and leaks nothing about the input or the output or the state. Okay. So in the real world, many applications are more efficiently captured by using RAM programs, as I just mentioned, the binary search and the membership statement proof. So you can see that if we use the circuit solution, we need to touch every bit of all data. And this makes the circuit size linear to the size of the data. And this also makes the running time linear to the size of the data. But in the run program, we only need to touch the data that will be used in the run program, which means this can make our run program sublinear to the size of the data. So we can see that the complexity of the circuit can maybe exponentially worse than the RAM program. So we need some solutions that the cost depends on the RAM, rather than the size of the data. Our inspiration is from the RAM two-party computation from the paper Golden and others 2012. The idea is to repeatedly evaluate the next memory access circuit. And it is a semi-honest 2PC protocol of RAM program, and the cost is proportional to the RAM program. So to achieve the malicious security, we could adopt another paper, AMHR 2015, along with Arash. Okay. The idea is to extend the GKK protocol using cut and choose, and it is a malicious 2PC protocol of RAM program, and the cost is also proportional to the RAM program. Okay. But it still has limitations. It requires, the first one is that it requires many rounds of communications, which are proportional to the running time of a RAM program. And also, it needs to generate many circuits to perform the cut and choose. Okay. And in the next part, I'll show existing solutions, efficient existing solutions based on the garbled circuit, which is from the paper JKO 2013. The goal of this protocol is trying to prove that there exists a witness that satisfies some relationship R. And first, the verifier generates the garbled circuit that computes this relationship. And then both parties perform a committing OT. So the prover receives his while labels of the witness. Then the verifier sends this circuit to the prover. Now the prover can evaluate the circuit to obtain a single output while label Y, and which represents 0 or 1. And this indicates that if the statement is true or not. And then the prover commits to such a label. Now the verifier opens circuit, so the prover can check that if the circuit was constructed correctly. And if so, the prover will open the while label Y. Now the verifier can check if Y represents 1. If so, that means the statement is true, and the verifier will output accept. Okay. It's very simple and efficient. And it is malicious secure, but without using cut and choose. And only one circuit is needed. So an intuitive improvement is to combine this JKO protocol with the garbled RAM from the paper Liu and Ostrovsky 2013. So we don't have to generate many garbled circuits for cut and choose. Okay. So you can see this picture as an overview of the JKO protocol. Instead of using the garbled circuit, we can replace it with the garbled RAM. But this improvement also has limitations, since the garbled RAM requires many copies of garbled next memory access circuit and lots of other things inside those circuits. And we noticed that in the recent work, there are some improvements for this extra overhead inside these circuits. But it still costs some overhead. So in this table, you can see that the garbled RAM and the JKO, it has a constant runs, but it requires extra overhead in set circuit. And the AMHR has no extra overhead, but but the number of runs is proportional to the RAM program. So in our work, we want to achieve both of the properties. Our protocol is trying to find a more efficient RAM, and only one circuit is needed. And it has no extra overhead inside the garbled circuit. And it has a constant runs of interaction. And also, the running time depends on the RAM program, which can be sublinear in the size of the data. So to be more precisely, our protocol has amortized the cost by reusing RAM initialization. That means we have a one-time initialization at the very first beginning. So the prover needs to commit to the memory M, and this cost depends on the size of the M. And for each proof, then we can have the cost depends on the running time of R instead of the size of M. So in this part, I will show you how we achieve these properties. For the first improvement, we can observe that the prover knows all the inputs, including the public LAN program R and also the memory contents M. So we can see that the prover can execute this OLAM locally and learn the memory access pattern I in advance. Then due to the OLAM security, this access pattern I leaks no information to the wild file. And then based on this access pattern, the wild file can construct one single circuit that can perform all computations. And then since there is no input from the wild file, then which means there is no privacy for the wild file, then we can use some more efficient gobbling scheme, such as the paper FNO 2015, the privacy-free gobble circuit. So in this picture, you can see that this is how it looks like when we convert the LAN program to circuit. So since we cannot predict the access pattern in the original JKO protocol, then we need to touch every, then for each smaller circuit, we need to touch every data in the memory. But if we know this access pattern I in advance, then we know which data will be used in the LAN program. Then the wild file can just generate a large circuit that contains a smaller circuit, which each smaller circuit just compute one LAN step. And when the wild file knows this I, the wild file then knows which data will be used in this circuit. Okay? So we don't have to touch every data in the memory, only the data in I. So this is the JKO protocol, and to see the improvements, before the wild file generates a circuit, the prover will compute this access pattern I, and then send this I to the wild file. Based on this access pattern, the wild file can generate the one big circuit that perform all computations. To see the improvement number two, we adopt the idea from our another paper, AHMR 2015, by reusing the wild labels. The main idea of this paper is that the prover stores the OLAM memory and the state as wild labels. So these wild labels can be reused directly as input to the next circuit. So this avoids the obvious transfer for the gobbler circuit input. So for example, suppose we have two proofs, R1 and R2. And in this small circuit one, it writes some data to the memory block, like 30. And in the next proof, R2, the circuit number four wants to read the data from that memory block. Since the prover already has these wild labels, and then the prover can just use these wild labels directly as the input to the R2. And this can help us to avoid the obvious transfer. But there's a big problem. As you can see that in the original JKO protocol and in the improvement one, we need to open the gobbled circuit. And that means when we open the gobbled circuit, both wild labels will be revealed to the prover. And then the authenticity property is lost. Here, by authenticity, I mean before the proof that the prover only knows one of the two wild labels, and after the proof, we still have the same property, and the prover still only knows one of the two wild labels. Okay, so that's what I mean by authenticity. So as you can see in these two proofs, the prover can successfully cheat by just flipping the bit. So we cannot directly reuse the wild labels. We need somehow to transfer the authenticity. The idea is to use the private function evaluation of strongly universal hash functions. So what is a private function evaluation? Suppose we have a PFE functionality. It takes a hash function from the wild file, and also takes input of y from the prover, and it outputs h of y to the prover. It has some beautiful properties. The first one is suppose there are two possible inputs, y0 and y1, to this PFE, and the prover only knows y0. Then when we choose this hash function from the hash family randomly, then from the property of the PFE, the prover knows nothing about this edge. And based on that, from the strong universality of h, if the prover knows h of y0 and learns both of y0 and y1, then the prover can still not guess this h of y1. So how it works in our protocol? Suppose in the first proof R1 has two possible output y labels, y0 and y1, and suppose the prover holds y0, then the verifier will choose this hash function h and sends it to the PFE, and also takes this PFE takes the input of y0 and sends this h of y0 to the to the verifier, and then to the prover, then the prover can use this h of y0 directly as an input to the next proof. As long as the verifier gobbles the circuit with h of y0 and the h of y1. Okay. And we need something more about this PFE, since we need to open the gobble circuit and both y labels and also this h, that means this PFE must be committing with respect to the input of h. So I'll give you an example of this committing PFE. So we have the function ax plus b is strongly universal. It takes a and b from the verifier and x from the prover, then gives the output ax plus b to the prover. Here, x and a and b are in the finite field f. And this can be efficiently instantiated via the oblivious transfer or the oblivious linear function evaluation. So as you can see, the difference between the improvement one and two. So before we open the gobble circuit, we use the PFE to transfer the authenticity from the previous variable to the new variables. So in summary, our protocol has a sublinear amortized cost, and the initialization depends on the size of M. And it has a constant number of interaction, and it avoids the cryptographic operation inside circuit. And one thing I didn't mention here is that since the verifier needs to open the wire labels to the prover, that means the verifier needs to store all wire labels in its memory. That means we need the storage of the verifier needs the storage proportional to the size of data. But in our work, we have fixed this problem. We also make the storage of the verifier has a constant storage. Okay, for the future work, as you can see that in this genealogy proof, if we can compute this access pattern in advance, then we can greatly improve the efficiency of the protocol. So we wonder that if we have some useful information, like this access pattern I, and that can be computed in advance in the general case, not just in the genealogy proof. And then this can help, if we have this advice, that can help improve the efficiency. Okay. And that's it. Thanks for the IACR and the sponsor to support the students presenter and cover the accommodation and the traveling. And that's it. Thanks for listening.